So for this episode of The Vote, we're going to be speaking to the Labour MP for Brighton Kemptown, Lloyd Russell-Moyle. Lloyd spoke to me about the coronavirus outbreak and the issues surrounding that in our city and beyond, including a national update from Westminster and the UK Parliament. Here's what he had to say. So I'm joined here again by Lloyd Russell-Moyle, MP, the MP for Brighton Kemptown. Welcome back, Lloyd. There's a lot of discussion now talking about how we rebuild our economy, both nationally and locally. There's a big campaign that started, Save Our Venues, which tries to preserve the music venues that we have, not just in Brighton, but elsewhere as well. How do you think we can make that happen? Not just music venues, but our economy locally. What do you think we need to do going forward?
Well, the local economy, of course, is very heavily linked to hospitality, tourism, entertainment. I mean, that's what Brighton was founded on, wasn't it? So let's be very clear why Brighton was founded, and we need to keep that going. Now, there's a number of things that we can do. One is that we and others are calling on the government to make sure the furlough schemes and other schemes continue, not until just the end of lockdown, but until places can get their feet back, themselves back on their feet. And that might mean some additional grants and support. We think that some of the small loans should be converted into grants. Rather than putting people in debt, we should be trying to boost them. But locally, we need to start thinking really creatively now. There might be some opportunities in post-COVID. Air travel, we already know, is going to be restricted because people coming in from long distance are going to have to wait 14 days. And it might mean that people stay at home more, so we have more home visitors. And Brighton might be an ability to attract them. But there's no point in attracting them if some of our venues go down. And so we need to make sure our venues stay open. Where there are high rents, we need to negotiate better rents for the transitionary period. And look, Peter, Caroline and I have been on a number of calls across the city about this. And we're determined that even if it means that we have to go out and be the salespeople of the city, getting people back to Brighton when it's the right time is really key. Now is not the right time for people to come to Brighton, and they shouldn't. But when it's time, we want to put on a good show for them. And it might well be that we do some kind of extravaganza, bring people down, those kinds of activities. All these ideas are in the pot, but we need to make sure venues survive first.
Yeah, exactly. Because I add a lot to the vibrancy of the city, particularly in the Kemptown area. But I'm also thinking other major cities like Cardiff, for example, Newcastle. There's some other cities which you know thrive on that live music scene, don't they?
Yeah. I think we're very aware of that in the Labour Party. The Conservatives are waking up to that slowly. I mean, the other problem is the events industry, which is very closely linked to music venues. A lot of music venues don't necessarily operate full capacity all year round. They operate with a set of events, whether it's the festival, whether it's Pride, whether it's another music events, you know, kind of that happen around the year. And they operate seasonally. And there's a real danger that we will come out of lockdown as the season is ending and then expect places to get going in the winter months, which is not usually the best months, apart from maybe some Christmas bookings around the year. So we need to make sure that the timing is correct as well for those kinds of venues. And I think there is a real worry that we would lose that. And we've been pressing that to the government. And I think that they're starting to get that now.
Yeah. What about the tourist economy in general? Because people are going to be having more staycations, aren't they? Staying in the UK probably later on this year. So how do you see, what would you do in order to revive the tourism and hospitality industries in particular? What other measures might you do?
Let us know how exactly this is going to work out.
Yeah.
But let's assume that it will mean more staycations, we can hope, for the time being. And that might mean places like Brighton become busier. And I think that means that we need to become a city that can accommodate all different kinds of people, not just for the daytime visitors, but visitors for a few nights, family friendly, as well as, of course, the stag and hen do. I mean, we mustn't, it's tempting to get frustrated at them because they can be disruptive sometimes, but they are also an important part of the Brighton economy. I think that means the city council needs to understand zoning understand that actually we want people to be able to enjoy themselves on, you know, kind of a drunken weekend as well as a artistic and historical weekend or whatever turns them on. So we need to think about those things, but we also need to think about pump priming. Let's make sure now, of course, the new shelter hall was meant to be open this summer. Let's make sure that it's up and running, visitors to hit it with its fantastic food hall that is meant to be there. Let's make sure all those arches where there are nightclubs and venues along are up and ready to hit the ground running. Let's make sure Kemptown and St. James's Street really has the ability for cafes to spill out onto the street, because one of the things that is likely is that places will be able to open, but there will be some sort of social distancing, so you'll be able to sit outside. So let's make sure we have room for them to do that. That requires some bold thinking, and I know that some of my colleagues in the council are doing that at the moment. We now need to make them into fruition.
Yeah. What about the national picture then? Do you, what do you think about the government scheme so far, the furloughing scheme, you know, the scheme for the self-employed?
The furloughing scheme has been very successful.
Yeah. And I think the self-employed scheme has been very successful where it has reached the right people. The problem has been that there has been a number of loopholes that the government haven't been willing to accommodate, which I think is a great shame. And I personally think that it would have been easier and quicker for the government to have given a universal credit to everyone of, say, £1,000, £2,000 for the period, and then claimed it back on tax. So those who continued earning would have ended up paying the £2,000 or maybe even a bit more back in tax, because you would have adjusted the tax code.
Yeah.
And those who weren't earning would have then gained it, and it would have reduced the paperwork. It would have got the money out to people quickly. Now, it didn't happen, and so it's a bit late to ask for that now, but I think there is some sort of questions around universal credit, universal basic income going forward, and I think there is some issues around making sure that we get things like universal credit right. The business schemes are a bit more patchy. The small grants have worked, but in Brighton we haven't got them out quick enough, and there's some issues there. And nationally, for medium-sized businesses, which have affected Brighton as well, it means that some businesses lose out, particularly if you are property rich but income poor. And we know many places are property rich but income poor. Bed and breakfasts are a great example. Small hotels are a good example. Venues actually are a good example where their tax base is based on business rates, could be quite high, and therefore they're excluded from any support. But actually they're quite small businesses. And what ends up happening is you could have quite a big business, but having a small tax base, they get more support. So there were some inconsistencies in it. And then the other thing, requiring it to be loans, I understand that for the very biggest businesses, but for some of those medium-sized businesses, has not helped at all. And now, of course, we see the issues with Gatwick and BA and Virgin and EasyJet. Now, that we want to eventually move away from air travel. We want to do that in a planned way where we find alternative forms for people to travel, because traveling around the world is so important. It enlightens us, it gives us new experiences. And so it's not as simple as just saying, get rid of all those jobs. And my suspicion is some of the airlines are using it to reconsolidate and put people on worse contracts than maybe they were. I will be doing a Zoom, Facebook, live event on Thursday with our Shadow Minister for Aviation and our the union reps from Gatwick Airport to talk about that, so people can listen in, and I'm sure your listeners and you can take clips of that as need be. So there are some things that we're working on there, but I am worried about that wider tourist economy.
Yeah, because Gatwick is going to, what's going on at Gatwick with BA putting out I think Virgin Atlantic as well, that's going to have an impact on our city, isn't it? And Greater Brighton area as well. The kind of the aviation industry does impact directly on Brighton, but other cities nationally, all major airports are key components of any economy, local economy.
Yes, and of course we want those airports to green. We don't want them to necessarily grow. We want them to transform into other areas, but we don't just want it to be the British Airways moves all their planes to Heathrow, which will not help the issues around Heathrow at all.
Yeah. Moving on, Lloyd, what about generally, how do you think we can reboot the economy going forward? not just tourism and hospitality, but in general, how can we create those new jobs of the future? Because a lot of changes.
I'm a bit of a Keynesianist. Yeah. I believe that you have to put money in to be able to get money out. Some people would say you've kind of got to speculate to profit. However you see it, the government has now a role to play in. And I think there's some issues around national security that we need to think about as well in our economy.
So that's it for the first half. Join me for the second half. I'll be speaking to Lloyd Russell-Moyle, MP, more about the coronavirus outbreak, the issues it's raised in our city, and also about that recovery both locally and nationally. So join us for the second half shortly. So welcome back to The Vote with Mark Walker. I'm speaking to Lloyd Russell-Moyle, MP, the MP for Brighton Kemptown. I'm going to be speaking to him further about the coronavirus outbreak, both locally and nationally, including that recovery, which is going to be needed in our city. Here's what he had to say. Moving on, Lloyd, what about generally, how do you think we can reboot the economy going forward? Not just tourism and hospitality, but in general, how can we create those new jobs of the future? Because a lot of changes.
Clearly, there was a weakness that we relied on things like hand sanitizers and garments to be made in Turkey and China and Bangladesh, when we needed some of that capacity here. And I think that this should be a wake-up call. Not that we have to make everything in Britain, but that we need to grow some of our manufacturing base. We need to understand that the government should support some of that a bit so that we have that permanent base to be able to, just like we say that we need to have a basic capacity to feed ourselves. And that's why we have agricultural policies, because we understand that if the worst came to the worst, it might not be a very varied diet, but we would have to survive on what we can produce. We also need to think that about other essentials that we have now. And it doesn't mean that we need to produce all of it. We maybe can club together with Europe and other nearby neighbours. But what we can't do is just rely on one country or two countries. We need to have a much more resilient network. And our economy must play a role in that. And that, I think, could provide some great opportunities for our economy. But it will only happen if the government is really proactive in then seeking out those opportunities. Because other countries will come along and grab them with two hands if we're not there.
Yeah, exactly. Finally, Lloyd, what about Keir Starmer, obviously new Labour leader? How do you think he's done so far?
Well, I think he's been very good indeed, particularly around questioning the Prime Minister in a clear way, not letting the waffle get in the way, but understanding that this is a national emergency. Now, there are always policies that I would like us to go further on, to be stronger on, to be clearer on. There always will be, but it's a balance. And I think that balance is the kind of area where Keir is getting it right. And I think the public will see. And now where you've seen Boris Johnson going off on a tangent, effectively breaking a union approach across the country, Wales, Northern Ireland and Scotland have stuck with their stay-at-home advice, but Boris has given this very confusing advice that's not clear for anyone at the moment and is very dangerous if it goes wrong. And you effectively now have a border at Wales and at Scotland. This is a remarkable situation. And I think that Keir's approach, where he said we should be going more in tandem with our union partners, is actually something that is right and will win out in the end. We should be dealing with this by the system of a precautionary principle. That means we don't know all the facts. It's a new disease. It's a new virus. And that means we should be cautious in the steps that we make and not gung-ho. And that is, I think, what you see in the character of Keir.
Yeah. And your own job as Shadow Minister for Air Quality, Lloyd, cycling and walking is being heavily encouraged now. I've seen a new cycle lane in the city. That seems to be working out well. It can only be good for air quality, can't it? Those sorts of measures.
Well, we're very worried that the advice, everyone go back in their cars, don't take public transport, will decrease air quality. And with COVID and everything else, we know that air quality is an exacerbating factor. And so we must make sure we don't return back to poor air quality. That's why we'll be working very hard in rolling out some policies in the next week or two to say how the Labour Party believes we should be harnessing this new drive for air quality, active transport, cycling, walking, and other forms of transport that can both be safe from COVID and safe for the environment. There are some real win-wins here that we could get if we harness them.
Yeah, pedestrianising roads, it does seem to work. It's worked along Brighton Seafront, I think it's probably safe to say. Yeah. Okay, we'll leave.
As you know, I would like a pedestrianised zone, only a small one,
yeah,
from the bottom of St James's Street up to Madeira Place, used to be called German Place until the Second World War, and they changed. I wonder why they changed that name. But yes, what's now called Madeira Place, where the St James's Tavern is and Dorset Gardens intersects with St James's Street. Only a very short bit of pedestrianisation, but I would pedestrianise that, and then I would create shared spaces down Manchester Street, down some of those where you are. So of course cars can come up to access their own garages, but apart from that, you wouldn't have any transport coming up there. And I think you would see a flourishing then of those businesses that are down some of those side streets, George Street as well, real flourishing of businesses, but also a real flourishing of ability for cafes and restaurants and bars to put seats on the outside to really make that a vibrant area. I'm not talking about all the way up, because of course there's access needs further up, but I think up to there you could do that. Now, of course, I know it's controversial, but if you put the bus stop at the bottom of St James's Street, people wouldn't have to walk very far, not much farther at all than they do at the moment from Morrison's. They could get on their bus, and the bus would still be in the same time, basically, at the Co-op bus stop, which would remain open. To me, that is a sensible solution in our area, and there are many other little areas where we could get that done. There's some issues around Rottingdean High Street that we need to look at, because the pollution there is very poor as well. But I think some pedestrianisation, shared use, diverting traffic to different kinds of places, I think that could be a real alternative for us. It's not going to work everywhere, but it will work some places.
Yeah.
Seems a good idea. So let's see what happens at local council on that, Lloyd. Thanks for talking to us again. All the best for the future. Obviously, we're going to catch up again soon anyway. So thanks, Lloyd.
Yeah, you too.
Cheers. Thanks.
Thank you very much.
Thanks. Bye-bye. Bye. So we're here at Madeira Terraces along Brighton Seafront, and the reason is because over the festive period there was a substantial amount of metal theft from Madeira Terraces. As you can see from the roofs here along here, there's been copper and steel and other metals have been stolen from the building. So we're going to find out the views from some local residents and see where we go from here.
We've lived here all our lives, you know, and it's gradually deteriorated over the years. But it's got such a state now where it obviously needs a lot of money spent on it, and it's just, can the council come up with the money for it?
Being a Brighton resident, you're quite ashamed because it looks so rough. And now you've told me that some's been stolen, I mean, yeah, it's terrible. I mean, they won't get caught, will they? And it'll be flogged off somewhere. I don't know what to say about that, really. I mean, what can they do?
I just don't understand, because they were aware that it was copper and lead, and those things get stolen very easily. So I don't understand why the council haven't protected it, haven't had some sort of security around it, because it's well known that that material is stolen. To have something like this on the seafront is an amazing thing that we should protect. So absolutely, I can't see that anybody would disagree with that. Or it would cost money, but it's well worth it. It's a seaside resort. Tourism is big business. It attracts people. So why not? To have something like this is an amazing thing that lots of seaside towns don't have and should protect.
I don't know what they expect, like, if you're just going to leave it lying around, people are just going to start nicking bits off it, so.
Yeah, I mean, I don't live in Brighton, but seeing it like this is not really nice.
I think the main thing for me is I'd like to see it become more of a sort of as a covered walkway, something more than that, maybe a bit something for that creates a bit of community. So, you know, there might be space for market stalls or something that, yeah, something sort of open air that gets people coming down here.
Lloyd Russell-Moyle, welcome back to Latest TV News. Lloyd, Why is this budget important for our city?
Well, it's important for our city that we get a budget so that we can operate for the next year. The government cuts continue to bite down on local government, and so we have to think of more creative ways to ensure that we preserve services, that we develop new income revenues, despite what the Conservatives are trying to do to local government. And I think what's important here in the city is I think the mandate at the last general election and the last local elections here was the people in Brighton want Labour and Greens to work together to make sure we have a prosperous city. That's what I think we've seen here tonight. A number of amendments, protecting services, restoring small bits of money that would make the real difference, say in the women's sector or say in some of the special needs reforms, are really coming forward both by creative and collaborative working from the Labour administration, supported by the Greens and vice versa. And I think that's really a move forward in this city. I can remember sitting in budgets where we would be sitting until 1 or 2 in the morning. We wouldn't even know if there was going to be an outcome, and we were thinking about having to come back the next day. And now it looks like we're broadly able to agree, and even it might be that we're able to get a cross-party consensus on this motion on the Madeira terraces.
Yeah.
Greens and Labour have agreed. The Conservatives at the moment are holding out on some dot points and some extra bits and bobs, but really, saving the Madeira terraces was key as well.
Yes.
This collaborative working, I think, is really positive, and hopefully this budget continues that train.
So there you have it. That is what Lloyd Russell-Moyle MP had to say about the coronavirus outbreak, both in our city and nationally. We got an update from Lloyd about how he thinks the city should recover going forward, as well as that update from Westminster and the UK Parliament. Thank you for joining me. Speak to you soon.